All right, well, thank you everybody for coming out to listen about my favorite subject, turtles. And hopefully by the looks of the smiling faces out here, it might be some of your favorite subjects as well. Now the title of my talk, the title of my talk is The Big Turtle Year in the Connecticut Turtle Atlas. The Big Turtle Year is a project that I did with the Florida Turtle Conservation Trust. And the Connecticut Turtle Atlas is a citizen science project to the Bruce Museum. And I call these exercises in conservation awareness because these are not strictly research projects. These were more of an awareness program to let people know about the plight of turtles, the conservation threats that they face, the challenges they face, but also some things that people and institutions and organizations can do to save them. So the ecological importance of turtles, people may not think much about the lowly turtle they see basking on a log in the sunshine in the spring, or a snapping turtle lumbering through the ponds and the lakes of our areas, but they are very important animals in the ecosystem. One thing about them that is the most important thing to know, they are long-lived, slow-growing species. Some species approach generation times, sometimes surpass generation times, of humans. Some species mature in as quickly as 3 to 5 years. Others may take 15 to 20 years to mature and start reproducing and laying eggs. Some of those species that take that long to mature may live upwards of over 100 years. You always hear people talk about, oh, this turtle in this zoo is 200 years old, this is 150, this one's 500 years old. Nobody knows these upper limits of turtles because nobody has studied them for that long. We do know that specific species like spotted turtles, which are Connecticut's one of their smallest species, only get about 4.5 inches, they have been known to live up to about 108 years, which is incredible for such a small animal. Since they do live a very long time, the whole life history of a turtle is to live as long as you can, reproduce as long as you can, and create as many babies as you can. Because with those babies, they are important in the food chain. All of the eggs that a turtle lays, you may only get about 1% of a female's entire life of reproduction that makes it to adulthood. The rest of those become embroiled in the nutrient cycle. So they become food for crows, for raccoons, for herons, foxes, skunks. That's just before they even hit the water with the aquatic species. Then you've got a lot of fish and things to eat them. So they are important as both predators and prey. And as such, they are significant contributors to that nutrient cycle. A lot of species are also seed dispersers. Things like the eastern box turtle that we have here in Connecticut eat a lot of fruits and flowers that fall to the ground. And as they scoot around through the forest, defecating, they release those seeds. Some seeds actually germinate better once they've gone through the digestive tract of a turtle. So it actually encourages seed production. Some species play roles as keystone species, which means they are the cornerstone of that ecosystem. Things like the gopher tortoise in the southeastern United States, they create burrows in upland habitats that provide a refuge for at least 365 other species. They provide refuge permanently, as in little burrows, for beetles and mice and indigo snakes and pine snakes and spiders. But they also provide refuge from the fires that move through these systems and that this ecosystem needs. So that would be a keystone species. If the gopher tortoise was completely removed from these ecosystems, the ecosystem would eventually collapse because all the other species depend on them. Some species are known as umbrella species, which means that if you protect that species, you de facto protect a lot of others because they are such an important and visible element in that landscape. Also, species serve as environmental barometers, kind of like the canary in the coal mine. Things like the flattened musk turtle, which I'll talk about a little bit. One of the ways that you can tell that the environmental health of the area they live in is when that turtle declines. That means that the entire ecosystem in the water is declining because their food base is going away, and I'll talk about that a little more. Now, turtle conservation needs. Currently, turtles are the most endangered vertebrate group in the world. And we're not just talking about a species, we're talking about an entire class of animal. 59% of all turtle species are threatened or endangered in some form. And when you consider there's only about 413 species in the world, that's pretty significant. Many of the turtle species are imperiled and in dire need of conservation attention. Luckily, there's a number of organizations that are out there either buying land to protect their habitat, dealing with confiscations through the pet trade. One recent one, a couple years ago, there were 10,000 radiated tortoises were confiscated in Madagascar that were being smuggled out for the pet trade. Just imagine that, 10,000 animals. There was another species, the Philippine pond turtle. There was a huge confiscation about 4 years ago. And I think the number, if I can remember right, the number that was confiscated was somewhere around 4,000 animals. It was just under, I think. That was more than the entire known population. They only thought there were less than 2,000 of those animals in the wild. And here was one confiscation with more than double that. It's can be kind of scary. Turtles face a broad range of threats and conservation challenges, some which we will talk about in the presentation. Now, the United States is the top turtle-rich country. You can see here we have 62 species in the United States. When you consider the other subspecies, we have 89 different types of turtles in the United States. The closest comes to that is Mexico. So you can kind of see that list. So the United States is a very important area, but we get less of the conservation attention. You hear a lot about sea turtles in the world, especially in the Caribbean and maybe in Florida. You hear a lot about the Galapagos tortoises, and you may even hear nowadays in the news about the Asian turtle crisis and turtles being used as traditional Chinese medicine and for food. But you hardly ever hear of the conservation needs of any species in the United States. So the project that I'm going to be talking, the first project, is entitled The Big Turtle Year. And we stole that idea. My research partner and I, George Heinrich, he's the president and founder of the Florida Turtle Conservation Trust. He's based in St. Pete, Florida. He came up with that idea years ago. There is an informal contest with birders. It's called The Big Year. And the contest is to see as many turtle species as you can in the wild in 1 year. So he thought, well, we should do that for turtles. And his initial thought was to do it in Florida. And me, with my big mouth, I said, well, Florida, you could probably do in a month. Why don't you do the whole United States? So I think now he probably wants to kick me for that, because it turned out to be a huge project. But the inspiration also came from the movie, The Big Year, if anybody's ever seen that. It's a great movie with Steve Martin. So just to tell you a little bit about the Florida Turtle Conservation Trust, we were formed in 1999 by a group of conservation biologists, researchers, and educators that were concerned about the conservation outlook of Florida turtles. Florida is the most turtle-rich state in the United States with 26 species. So if you like hot weather, if you like beautiful rivers and turtles, Florida is the perfect place. I lived there for about 36 years and kind of moved up here about 6 years ago. So I still have field projects there that I go down about 2 to 3 times a year. So the Big Turtle Year is an initiative, as I said, of the Turtle Trust. So once we started, the idea was to travel around the United States to see as many of the 59 species as we could in 1 year. That makes for a challenging project. With 50 states and 59 species, we tried to pick areas that were going to be the most turtle-rich, turtle-concentrated areas. And we didn't just want to make a project where we got to go out in the woods and the fields and see turtles just for our own good. So we created a website, a blog. We partnered with a lot of organizations and groups. And the main goal was to meet up with other researchers in their field areas, in their areas of expertise, and go out and find these species with them. That was for multiple reasons. We wanted to get their take on turtle conservation issues in their specific areas. And also, if you were just to try to take a field guide and go out and say, I want to find a yellow mud turtle, good luck. Because they're only active at certain times of the year, certain weather. So to go out with a researcher at a known site when he or she knows when their animals are going to be active was key to this project being a success. And you can go to our website, thebigturtleyear.org, And we have a blog that lists all of our trips, photos, all the information that happened. So with a project this big, you can imagine it's probably fairly costly. So initially we set up a GoFundMe site and got a few donations that way. But we really had a couple of long-term supporters and patrons of the Turtle Trust that really stepped up and provided money. And this was to cover airfare, lodging. We were very particular about what we paid for the trip, so we didn't pay for our meals and this kind of thing. So it was really just the logistics of the project, and that helped bring costs down as well. So the first day of the project was January 1st, 2017. This is my research partner, George Heinrich. He has a study site across the street from his house, the Boyd Hill Nature Preserve in St. Petersburg, Florida. So there's no way we could go look for turtles in Connecticut on January 1st, but it was probably about 75 degrees that day. He walked across the street and found 9 gopher tortoises in one day. And this is a study site that he has been working on for over 20 years. So as I take you through this project, realize that you are going to get in just a small snippet view. George has now gone through, next week will be his 30th presentation on this project, and his presentations usually run an hour and a half to 45, hour and 45 minutes, and he barely scratches the surface of all the species, all the people, and all the places that we visited. So this was a big undertaking, but I just want you to get a decent flavor for the project. So these are two turtles here. On your left is a Florida red-bellied turtle. On your right is a Swanee cooter, which is my primary research species that I've been working on for about 15 years. And the Rainbow River is a fantastic river in Florida. It's just west of Ocala, crystal clear. Deepest part of the river is, I think, 49 feet. And if you are snorkeling from the surface, you could see a quarter on the bottom. It's beautiful. In a good day, you could see 7 species of turtle. So it's a really, really good spot. So this river we saw, I think that time, 6 species in that day. We got loggerhead musk turtle, Florida red belly, peninsula cooter, Swanee cooter, Florida softshell turtle, and common snapping turtle. So that was a good trip. Now I will have to say that George did most of the research trips. I went on 2. This trip, there were 12 multi-day trips, which included traveling to other states. We went to 13 states. There were 70-night overnight days with this trip. And just to give you one example, when George traveled with a colleague through Texas, they were in Texas for 10 days. They drove 2,430 miles. So at some point with this project, we're going to calculate how many air miles, how many land miles, all this to just get picture of how large of an undertaking this was. So out of those 12 trips, I did 2. And that was basically the fact that I have a full-time job, I have bosses, he works for himself, so he had a little more flexibility. One of the trips that I participated on was we did a New Jersey, Connecticut, Massachusetts trip. This is one of my biggest contributors to the Connecticut Turtle Atlas, which I'll be talking about next. This is Barry Robbins Pianca up in Middletown. She has a spotted turtle, painted turtle, and snapping turtle site near her house. So the majority of the people in my Connecticut Turtle Atlas, the majority of the observations are her. She's very prolific and just a wonderful individual. And she took us out to her site and we captured a spotted turtle that you can see here. And that is a full-grown spotted turtle. This area is adjacent to unused railroad tracks, and they always get up in the railroad tracks on the railroad ties, especially in the springtime now, to absorb the spring heat. So when they come out of their hibernation, and this is a species that comes out probably the earliest. They're known to bask on snow banks when it's sunny and warm. And this is a species that's very prevalent in the pet trade. They're a very small, attractive species, easy to keep, personable. So they are collected by the thousands. So what we did with this project is when we were writing our blog, and we were very mindful about letting people know of certain sites. So if you do go to our blog and read, you'll say that we visited a site in Middletown, Connecticut. That's all we gave. We didn't give, you know, any adjacent highways because it is too easy for poachers to distill this information. All of the photos that we took with our cell phones, because that's always the best camera that you have, is the one you have with you. We had to scrub the location data off of that because poachers will go through websites and they will pull GPS locations off of photos if you're not careful. So a number of our sites were not disclosed. Some of the ones that were state parks and such that have species checklists that are widely available, we went ahead and identified those, but we didn't specifically say where in the parks we were, just to make it a little more difficult for people. This is Harris County, Texas. This is outside of Houston, which is a newly found alligator snapping turtle site. These turtles were just found there a few years ago, and they've now been found in one of the tributaries that goes through downtown Houston. This is a species that is known for its large size. This individual, I forget how much it weighed, but I think this one, just by looking at the photos, probably about 135 pounds. The species is known to get up to 248 pounds. The females rarely exceed 45 pounds. And when they do exceed it, they probably don't go over 50 pounds, and that would just be a fat individual. So you have these massive males, small females, which is just the opposite for a lot of turtles. Most turtle females are larger because they're the ones that have to carry the eggs. So it's interesting in this species. But they have the snapping turtles have a bad reputation, and that's mostly because people are familiar with the common snapping turtle that we have here that are very belligerent when they're out of water because they feel vulnerable. The alligator snapping turtle is not aggressive like that at all. Whereas the common snapping turtle, if you see it out of the water and you approach it, it will strike at you violently. It'll lift itself off the ground. It's striking so hard. This animal just opens its mouth and faces you. So if you were to walk around it, it will just turn in a circle facing you. So it looks a lot meaner than it is. So this is an interesting turtle that was sighted. This is the, I always forget the name of this one. This is the rough-footed mud turtle. And I forget the name because with common names, sometimes there's multiple names. So this is also known as the plateau mud turtle and the Quito Piquito turtle. But this is the most endangered turtle in the United States. And it's endangered because it only lives in about 5 acres of land in extreme southwestern Texas. Most of this turtle's range is in Mexico. The status of it in Mexico is unknown because nobody works on it. But it lives in 3 ponds on 5 acres in Texas. And it's a turtle that only gets about 4.5 inches, very small turtles. And that's what a lot of people don't know, is how many species we have in the US that are diminutive, really, really tiny turtles. So it lives in these ponds that are known to dry up, and that's one of the big risks. They live in a small area. It's not a biggest risk for poachers because it's a little brown mud turtle. Nobody keeps little brown mud turtles, so the poachers don't go after the species because it's just not popular. But they have had to go in and make these ponds larger and deeper so they hold water during these droughts. So we traveled to, George traveled to California, and this is a site in Riverside County, kind of near the hill country outside of Los Angeles. And you don't think of this kind of habitat being outside Los Angeles. But this is the habitat of the Pacific pond turtle, another small species that get up to about 8 inches, and it lives in these kind of mountain streams. Now it can live in these areas that have a lot of riparian vegetation to hide in, or some of the creeks they live in are strictly just rock boulders. And the key problem for this species is drought. Of course, with the droughts that California has been having, a lot of these little reservoirs and creeks and ponds have dried up, and they've gone through and found dozens of deceased animals. There is a group called the Turtle Conservancy in Ojai, California, that has taken upon them to find some of the populations around them, and when they were drying up, they brought them into captivity temporarily until the areas filled back up, and then they were to release them. Now, when they released them, they marked them, they measured them, they took morphometrics, so now it's become a research population. And this is the Western pond turtle. Another kind of little brown turtle, but they have these beautiful modeling patterns that make them quite attractive. Now, I am jealous of George because he did get to go to some pretty exotic regions in the United States that I have never been to and hope to see someday. And one of those is this spectacular area, Desert Tortoise Natural Area, California. Just look at that view. To be out there looking for turtles and that, it was a thrill of a lifetime for him. The species he was out looking for here was the Sonoran desert tortoise. And you can see by that childish grin on his face, he was happy to find that day. This is a species that is affected by land use. When you have areas that are completely shut out from people, they do very well. Once you let in off-road vehicles, they don't do very well because the off-road vehicles, people don't stick to the trails. They just go completely off-road. They denude the vegetation. They crush tortoises themselves. They may even vandalize them by attacking them with implements, breaking their shell, painting on them. But also, interestingly, in these areas with this species and also the different species of desert tortoise, they're affected by crows and ravens that have become more populous around human habitation because they're what we call subsidized predators, much like possums and raccoons and vultures. They do very well along human habitation because there's a ready supply of food. Things with vultures, they do very well around people on highways because there's lots of roadkill. Raccoons and possums do very well around people because of our trash cans. Crows and ravens are the same way, they're scavengers. So when their populations become greatly increased, they start hunting baby tortoises. So what they are doing now, some researchers have made little epoxy tortoises as decoys to teach the crows that this is just an inert object. There's nothing to eat. So hopefully, eventually, they'll learn that even though they see that walking around, it's not something edible, which is an interesting way to do it. They're also using drone technology and air cannons to scare off crows and ravens. They've become that bad. Sometimes you can find under one raven nest over 100 little tortoise shells that they've been using to feed their babies in one season. So they're very, very, very damaging. Another area I went to, this was in Mississippi, the Bogachito River, which is just this coffee-colored, just muddy river, but the turtles are incredible. The southeast United States has a type of turtle called the map turtle, and it's called that because the nominate species has these beautiful kind of whorls on them that look like a topographic map. And there are a number of different species. Usually, the female is much larger than the male, so you would have a 9 to 10-inch female and a 4-inch male. When they were first described in the 1700s and 1800s, they were thought to be different species. So up here on your left is a ringed map turtle, and this is a full-grown adult male, about this big. On the bottom left is a razorback musk turtle, which is one of the larger musk turtles. They get about up to 7 inches, and these feed on mollusks. So they have very powerful jaws, very broad tomiums, which the turtle's beak, the turtles don't have teeth, they have a beak like a bird. Some species have serrated edges for cutting vegetation, some sharp for cutting fish when they eat. This species has a very broad plate and it's used for smashing clams and mussels and snails. So over here we have an adult male Pearl River map turtle, which a lot of the map turtles, especially when they're youngsters and the males retain these beautiful projections, kind of spikes in their shell. And then down below is a female Pearl River map turtle with a large head. With these map turtles, they're interesting because the females tend to have these broad heads that they eat mollusks. The males have smaller heads and they eat things like insect larvae. So they partition their diet out even within that species, which is interesting, so they don't compete with each other for food. So this is a site in southern Arizona. And this is another site that we were very careful not to give the exact location because of other species that were in the area. This is the Arizona mud turtle. Very nondescript. Like I said, most of the mud and musk turtles are just little brown turtles. Gets up to about 6 inches maximum. But they live in these kind of ephemeral ponds. This one is a cattle tank, what we would call a pond. Up here in the northeast, they call tanks in the west. So this is a pond that in the summertime will completely dry down. A lot of turtles are used to living in these ephemeral areas, and what they do is they go into the associated uplands and they bury down the ground, and they may be in the ground for 6 months, and they're only out for a certain period of time. So this is one of those cases where you really need to go out with a researcher to a known site to find these. If we were just to try to go out and find them, it would probably would not be successful. So George went out with a researcher with traps, and I think they caught about 83 turtles over the course of 2 days in five or six ponds. This was a trip that, one of the trips that I was on. This was a Alabama, Mississippi, and Louisiana trip. So we went to a very special place, the Bankhead National Forest, and this is the Black Warrior River system in northwestern Alabama, and it is home to a musk turtle called the flattened musk turtle, and it's down on the bottom right. Very small species, again, 5 inches would be maximum. And they're a musk turtle that instead of having a higher dome is depressed. And that's because they live in these rocky streams that they have evolved this lower show profile to wedge themselves into rock crevices, both to hide from predators, and also a colleague has noted that he thinks it's more evolved for when rainstorms come and these creeks flood, because some of these creeks will go from about a foot deep to 6 feet deep in a couple hours. And you can imagine the volume of water and the pressure of that water coming through. And he believes they have evolved this to be able to wedge themselves into the rock crevices so they don't get swept downstream. The turtle above is a young male Alabama map turtle. Now, the flattened musk turtle is a species that is on the brink in the United States. It gets zero conservation attention. It's federally threatened. There is virtually no money put towards its protection. Currently, there is one student working on the species. It inhabits 7% of its historic range, and it has become endangered because of coal mining. This area is very rich in coal mining, and all of the sediment from the mountaintop removal, the coal sediment flows into these watersheds, into these rivers, siltifies them, which kills off the algae that are on the rocks, which in turn kills the snails that feed on the algae, and also the mollusks, the mussels and clams that live in here that filter feed. They just get clogged up and they die. So that has completely removed the food base out of most of their streams that they live in. So it's a very sad situation for them. The Fish and Wildlife Service is now starting to pay a little more attention, so that is a good thing. Another thing with the species, they are involved in the international pet trade. So you can imagine an animal, once it's endangered, it drives up the price in the black market. And this species isn't attractive. These are not the best photos, but they have this beautiful modeling. They have the speckling on the shell. In fact, trying to find them is almost impossible. You have to walk around the shallow water, and you just try to find the one stone that's a little different than the others. In fact, this was a very cool moment. George and I had never seen the species, had never been to this area. We found these two individuals at the same exact moment. We were about 30 feet apart. I was walking in about a foot of water, and I saw a stone that looked a little different, and I didn't want to yell anything yet. So I reached down, picked it up. Sure enough, I reached up, and I said, "Turtle," at the same time, George, "Turtle." He got the little one, which is about a five-year-old individual. So that was a cool moment. We did include the sea turtles, which can be a little hard to get, but since they have very specific nesting periods, they're very well researched. Again, you have to partner with the right people. And this is a species I've never seen in the wild. This is the leatherback sea turtle, the largest of the turtles, which can approach 8 feet in length and 2,000 pounds. This was a good night for George. They got, I believe it was 9 loggerheads, 6 green sea turtles, and 3 leatherbacks in one night. So that was absolutely an amazing time. We traveled up the southwestern Michigan to a couple sites. Up here on the top, this is a Blanding's turtle. This is a beautiful turtle, about 8 to 10 inches. Just this gorgeous yellow speckling on the skin and also on the shell. They have these beautiful, fine little, almost like a spotted turtle, but finer markings. And this is a turtle that basks regularly. When you go to some sites, you can sometimes see dozens on one large log. They feed on a lot of insect larvae, tadpoles, and things of that nature. They are involved in the pet trade, but not as much. Then you have the ornate box turtle down here in the bottom, which is one of the western box turtle species, much like the eastern box turtle we have here. They just inhabit drier areas but have similar ecology. And then the species on your right is the North American wood turtle. which is a very attractive turtle. It looks like their shell has been carved out of wood. They are heavily collected for the pet trade. They can fetch large amounts, especially in the international pet trade. Some Japanese people who buy them on the black market can pay upwards of $3,000 for one animal. So you can imagine how lucrative it is for these poachers to try to go out into these areas and find them. This is another trip that I was involved with. We went over to New Jersey with the state herpetologist who studies turtles there, and we went to a bog turtle site, and the bog turtle is on the upper left. This is North America's smallest turtle, 4.5-inch adult. And you can see in the hand right there, my hand, that's an adult female turtle. The first site we went to was not the best habitat, but it had a lot of turtles. It had 35 known turtles that are marked for a study. We found 8 within about 25 minutes, which was pretty spectacular. And these things, they do what's called cryptic basking. They basically sit in the dappled sunlight, sometimes half buried in the mud just so the sun hits their shell. So they're very, very difficult to find. We went to 3 other sites and only found a couple of that species. And you can see them down here. This is after they've been found in the open. But the habitat they live in are these little tiny ditch-like rivulets with lots of sedges and pitcher plants, shady in areas, dappled sunlight, very, very difficult to find. But this is a species that is heavily in the international pet trade again. Even legal animals that you can purchase. There's one guy in Florida who breeds them regularly with permits. He has a waiting list of about 7 years for hatchlings. The hatchlings are about the size of your thumbnail. And I haven't priced them recently, but about 10 years ago, they were $750 for a hatchling. And then this is another wood turtle. Down here, you can see that sculpted shell, almost like it was carved out of wood. So the goal of this project was to find all 59 species. We did pretty well. We got 57 out of 59. And that took a lot of effort. This is one of the turtles that eluded us. This is the chicken turtle, and this is the Florida subspecies. A very common turtle in the southeast, but it's common locally, and they're seasonal. So they live in these ephemeral wetlands that dry up in the summer. They'll move 75, 100, 200 feet up into the uplands and dig in and sit there for 3 months until it rains again. We thought this was going to be one of the easiest species. George traveled to about 6 different sites, known sites that they were at with researchers that have found them before, nothing. This animal was found on the last day, on the last trip, at the end of the last road. And this was just one lone animal basking. This was probably about 75 feet away with a telephoto lens. So within this trip, we went to a lot of protected areas, which was really nice to see. So this is Joseph Jones Ecological Research Center, where they do a lot of gopher tortoise research. And just a variety of areas. And just because these are protected areas doesn't mean they're safe, especially in this day and age. One of the protected areas that they went to, National Butterfly Center, which is right now at the center of the border wall debate. As of right now, they have equipment already starting to cut a swath of about 175 feet through the preserve to create a border wall, which is now going to affect butterflies. So just because a place is protected doesn't mean it's safe. There's a lot of work to keep it safe. So as I said, we went after 59 species. We got 57. The only two that we did not get was a species of alligator snapping turtle. Recently, there have been new species found in the United States, and these are not cryptic species that were hiding from us. These are species that were found through genetic work, that if you look at species close enough over the range, especially species that are separated by rivers or significant different habitat, they are different genetically. So the Apalachicola snapping turtle was one of those. But we feel a little vindicated because that species, that subspecies, or that species has now been shut down. It's not a valid species. So technically, we didn't need to look for it. We didn't find it, but we didn't need to look for it. And then the yellow mud turtle. another one of those common Western species that everybody you talk to, oh yeah, I've got a site. I can, you know, we can catch 30 of them in a day. They went to about 6 different sites, didn't find one. So with this project, what's next? Nationwide lecture series, this is one of them. As I said, my research partner George, he'll be doing his 30th lecture on this project next week in Tallahassee, Florida. And I think that's about it. George is tired. Last year, he did about 83 days away from home. This year, I think he's approaching about 70 for this project. Because sometimes, if he goes and does a lecture, he doesn't want to just fly somewhere, do a lecture. He spends a number of days looking for turtles. We have a book project in the works. We have a pretty good extended outline, but we're just trying to find time now to write together, especially being separated by about 1,300 miles, so we do a lot of work on Skype. This year, George has been searching for the species that we were missing in the wild, so the yellow mud turtle is on that list. Also, since we did this project, there's been two new species named. One of the species, the Pacific pond turtle that I showed you outside of Los Angeles there, that one used to be part of a species that went all the way up to Washington. Now it's been split into two species. So now he's going to go up to the Washington-Seattle area and find that one. And then there's been a new musk turtle found in the Florida-Alabama border, and it's called the Intermedius musk turtle because it's kind of between two other species, but it was just hidden there. It's different just enough, a little bit morphologically, but genetically it's different. So as I said, this is kind of a list of, you can see different lectures. I know you can't read that, but you can. We've traveled to Arizona, California, New Orleans, lots of different places giving this talk. So as I said at the beginning, we couldn't have done this without a great deal of partners. And this is, I think, probably a partial list of everybody that helped us out. And these were people that helped us out, taking us out to field sites, logistics. A lot of friends and colleagues helped us out, but then us crash on couches and providing transportation, which helped lower the cost of the project. And we also partnered with a number of other organizations, institutions, colleges, and again, this is probably not all of them. So the next project I'd like to talk to you about is the Connecticut Turtle Atlas, and this is a citizen science project that I developed through the Bruce Museum. When I started with the Bruce Museum, I was brought on as a part-time citizen science coordinator, pretty much just to get me in the door, and our curator wanted to bring citizen science to the Bruce because it was kind of the new fad for museums to do. Even though citizen science had been around for a while. So before I get into the details of the project, I just want to walk you through quickly the species that we have here in Connecticut. Now, I have left the sea turtles off this list because they are transient species. They're not reproductive in this area. But we do have loggerhead sea turtle, green sea turtle, the Kemp's Ridley, which is an endangered species, and the leatherback do occasionally come into our waters. Most of the time when they're found, they're deceased specimens that have washed up on the beaches. So even though they're part of the Connecticut Turtle Atlas, I'm not going to discuss them in this presentation. The spotted turtle, we touched base with the Big Turtle Year Project. It's a fairly widespread species in Connecticut, locally abundant in specific habitats. They like ephemeral wetlands, especially ephemeral wetlands that are adjacent to permanent wetlands. So you'll have an area that's a seasonal swamp with things like rushes and skunk cabbage, but it might be right next to a permanent body of water, so that way they can choose what habitat they're going to be in. Again, very attractive turtle, very easy to keep, very prevalent in the pet trade. And with the Connecticut Atlas, I'll talk a little bit more. This is a project where people can record their observations on basically an international database. And we're very careful about the locations, and I'll tell you later how we protect the locations of some of these species. Eastern box turtle. Probably some of you that have been around a little longer than others remember a lot more box turtles 40, 50, 60 years ago. And that's because there were more. I can remember in Florida growing up, every time it rained, there were box turtles everywhere. Some roads you can go down and find 5 or 6 crossing a road. But those roads are the problem. This is a species that lives in a very small range its entire life, about the size of a football field. Hardly ventures anywhere outside of that. Sometimes males will take on larger territories, but they live in a very small space. So with habitat destruction and the encroachment of people for our homes and our shopping centers and our schools, that brings in roads. The more roads that transect a habitat, the more chances these animals have of getting hit by a car on the road. So that's been a big problem with box turtles and also the pet trade. Box turtles are collected heavily for the international pet trade because they're another small species, easy to keep. They're from temperate environments, so people in Europe that have, you know, very harsh winters like Connecticut can keep them outdoors and they can hibernate outdoors. So they're very, very popular. Diamondback terrapin. This is one of our most special turtles in Connecticut. This is the only estuarine turtle in the world. In this species, there's seven different subspecies around the United States. They go from the southern tip of Texas around Brownsville all the way up to Cape Cod. Now, when you look at that large range, you think, well, that's a huge range. But when you consider the narrow margin of space that they're inhabiting, they're only in brackish water. So, you know, you're looking at something that may only inhabit an area that goes a mile, maybe two at the most, inland. And then you're looking at habitats that are broken up by large expanses of sand beaches, development. When you start looking at the actual available habitat of the species, it's fairly small, even though they have a huge range. And this species is fairly common in Connecticut in certain areas. Greenwich Point, we do have some low-level nesting. There's an area adjacent to Sound Waters in Stanford where they get pretty heavy nesting. Stratford Point up near where I live, they have pretty good nesting as well. This animal is threatened mostly with habitat destruction, mostly with creating bulkheads, seawalls. You know, people don't like their coastal property to go right down into the Long Island Sound. They like to have, you know, a nice seawall there with a dock to put their boat on. Well, that seawall prevents the animals from coming up and nesting, so it really limits their available habitat. And then also, a big problem with the terrapins range-wide are crab traps. They find their way into crab traps. Crabbers don't check their traps every day because crabs can breathe underwater. The turtles drown. The most studied area is in New Jersey, and they have looked at, in years past, upwards of 15 to 17,000 terrapins a year drowning in crab traps. And then, to put something else on top of that, they are very prominent in the pet trade. One of the subspecies in the east coast or the west coast of Florida in the Gulf is the ornate diamondback terrapin, even more beautiful than this animal. And they fetch prices of $5,500 to $7,000 in the pet trade. This is by far the most common turtle in our waters. Just about any body of water, whether it be a small pond, lake, or river, you can see painted turtles basking on logs. Sometimes by the dozens, they can be pretty populated in these areas. So it's certainly not in any danger. The danger that comes with this species is in urban areas, parks, downtown parks, because there's a species of turtle called the red-eared slider that people buy as the pet for, used to be 25 cents, but now they're like $30. When those turtles get too big and messy, people tend to release them. And they don't release them in the natural area that's 20 miles away. They go down to the local park and release it. So areas like where I go to a lot, Binney Park in Old Greenwich, you will see sometimes 25 red-eared sliders and two painted turtles. So in these urban areas, the red-eared sliders can outcompete and push out these native species. But as a whole, this is a turtle that's probably least concern almost range-wide. The bog turtle we touched upon a little bit with the Big Turtle Year Project. There are only a handful of known sites in Connecticut. It's not very well studied. Connecticut DEEP guards those localities very closely. I've even inquired, and I would have to be put in touch with one of the researchers. I would have to be vetted as a researcher to even be taken out to a site. But absolutely gorgeous turtles. They live in these not quite ephemeral wetlands. They do have seasonal flooding, but they always have permanent water running through them. They're usually associated with sphagnum bogs. They do quite well in low-level ranching. So if there are cattle in the area, as long as there's not too many cattle, they can actually help out the bog turtle by keeping some of the understory trimmed. because if you get too many large shrubs invading their habitats, it shades out the nesting areas, shades out their basking areas, and it just drives the bog turtles out. Everybody's familiar with our local dinosaur, the common snapping turtle. Most people see them when they're out of the water, and like I said, they're very belligerent. The two species of snapping turtle have what's called a cruciform plastron. The bottom of their shell is called the plastron, and it is highly reduced. And it's because they have this large head and neck that they need to pull into that shell. When you think of a turtle, when they pull their head and neck in, their neck is doing an S-curve. So it hinges at the top of the shell, and it S-curves backwards. So with a thing like a snapping turtle, when it pulls its head all the way back, its part of its neck is almost touching its pelvis. So when you have that massive muscle, skin, and bulk that needs to be pulled in its shell, all of your other organs have to be displaced. So they've reduced that bottom shell, so when they pull that head in, their body just kind of bulges out. But because of that, they feel very vulnerable on land. And like I said, these things are quite vicious. If you get too close, they will strike with such force that'll lift themselves off the ground. Even a 30-pound animal I've seen come off the ground. Underwater, completely different animal. I've done film work and caught them underwater, scratched them on their chin, held them right in front of my face with a snorkel. Nothing aggressive. But as soon as their head pops out of water, they turn into Dr. Jekyll. Common musk turtle. This is a species that probably nobody has ever seen in Connecticut. It's quite rare this side of the Connecticut River. I do know of a couple specimens that were found in the Mayanus River. Adult length, 5 inches maximum. Males, adult, at about 2 inches. Very common turtle. They tend to just, like every musk and mud turtle, they're bottom dwellers. They're not very good swimmers, so they just kind of plod along the bottom and eat algae, snails, clams, crustaceans, aquatic insects. They're not too particular. I wish this was a species that was more prevalent in the pet trade, because since they're so small, they can be kept in a smaller aquarium. They don't get large, so people aren't going to dump them. They live a long time. They're personable. They're just not pretty. And that's a real shame, because these animals breed quite readily in captivity, so that would be a much better pet turtle than a red-eared slider. So as I said, the Connecticut Turtle Atlas is a citizen science project. And what citizen science does is it's to engage individuals within research process. It also promotes people's understanding of how science works. We hear the word science a lot, especially now in the news, mostly involving climate science. And personally, I think, at least since I've been in school, that science literacy has really declined. We don't teach real science anymore, especially things like biology and environmental science. So basic understanding of how these systems work is just not there in a large section of the population. And citizen science can help that, because people are actually involved, and you do more learning by being involved. It also encourages learning in the STEM disciplines, which are, of course, very important these days, the science, technology, engineering, and math. It empowers evidence-informed decision-making. Basically, if you know how these processes work, you can understand the results and the implications much better. And hopefully, especially with children, it can inspire the next generations of science, because every scientist will tell you, every biologist, we didn't start out in a laboratory. We started out catching frogs and tadpoles and butterflies in the woods. So to get people outside observing and researching is a pretty big deal. Now, the citizen science meets these goals by providing fun and interesting projects with real-world implications. The Connecticut Turtle Atlas, although it is a research project, right now I'm not using it as such. The data can be very valuable, especially if you collect the data over a long period of time, because as in the beginning I said, turtles are such long-lived animals. You can't just study a population for a year or two to understand anything. You have to monitor these animals for decades to really gather some good information. It breaks down the barrier between society and scientists. A lot of scientists have problems talking about their research to the general public. We're really good at writing specific pieces for academic journals that only other researchers can understand, but translating that information to the general public is difficult. And a few scientists do it very well, especially some of the video bloggers that are online. Emily Grassley, who's out of the Natural History Museum in Chicago, is really good at that. But citizen science projects can really help bridge that gap between the scientist and the regular person. Sharing outreach outcomes is much easier with your participants than them seeing a journal article that they don't understand. And then also acknowledging the participants' contributions. With a project like this, there is no way I could do a mapping project of the turtles in Connecticut by myself. It would cost tens of thousands of dollars. I would be gone away from home all the time traveling all of these different sites. But if you have 100 other eyes looking for you, it makes that workload much easier. So the Connecticut Turtle Atlas is it's both online and smartphone based. And it uses, I'll get to that in a minute, sorry. This project invites the public to assist in conserving the turtle diversity in Connecticut. Like I said, most people are probably familiar with the painted turtles and snapping turtles, but less familiar with the bog turtles and common musk turtles. So by being part of this project, you're being exposed to other people's observations, and it may encourage you to go find these other species and almost have like a contest, a little big turtle year of your own here in Connecticut. I've already discussed that turtles are highly endangered species. And the volunteers will collect data on specific locations, abundance, and also behavioral observations of turtles in the state. So I use the iNaturalist platform, which is based out of the California Academy of Sciences in San Francisco. And it is basically an online database that anybody can add to. It's an open source platform, so it's available to any organization or institution who wants to use it. So has anybody here heard of a thing called a BioBlitz? And it's basically an intense bio inventory of a specific place over a 24-hour period. Almost every BioBlitz that's done in the country now uses the iNaturalist platform. It's very good, very easy to use. So there is a web platform that you can go to a website. You can upload any photo that you've taken of a turtle in the wild. You can add, if it's not a geo-tagged photo from like a cell phone, you can use the map to pinpoint that specific location. You can add in any observations that you saw. You can talk about how many individuals you saw. You can put in the weather. The more detail that people give me, the more usable the data is. Currently with this project, we have 569 observations of 9 of the 12 species in Connecticut by 67 people. And this is now going into, I believe it's just the fourth year. So I think it's done very well. Like I said, right now I'm not using the data for any kind of research. I'm using it more for an awareness program just to get people excited and out looking for turtles. But I have had some informal conversations with some of the folks at the Connecticut Deep to maybe utilize this project for their observations. They use data sheets for people to collect information on things like diamondback terrapin, spotted turtles, wood turtles, but people have to print off the data sheet, they have to fill it out, they have to print out photos, send them, and then mail them in. That's a lot more difficult than people taking out their smartphone and taking a picture and uploading the data right there. So I'm hoping that they will be interested in using this data. The one important thing about iNaturalist and why I chose it is because I said locations of some of these species are very dangerous to have in the wrong people's hands. So iNaturalist, anything that is deemed vulnerable, threatened, or endangered by the International Union of Nature, their red data list, it obscures the public coordinates by, I think they've bumped it up to 26 kilometers now. So even though you'll see a dot on the map, that's not where that animal is found. It could have been found anywhere within a 26-kilometer radius. And that was huge. I found some other platforms that were a little more kid-friendly, but they didn't have that function. And if somebody was to go out and find a bog turtle and upload it to iNaturalist, you can guarantee you the poachers will be there tomorrow. So that was a very important feature of this. So as I said, it has a smartphone app. The way I've got it set up, there is a checklist of turtles. So if you're at a local pond or a lake, and you see a painted turtle, you just go to this list, you click add, it uploads it, uploads the location information, and then you can add any observations you want. One good feature about iNaturalist 2 is if you scroll down, if you don't see a turtle or if you don't know which one it is, you can click a button that says ID help, and that sends me an email, and I can look at the photo and then give you the correct identification for that. So it's a really, really usable program. So the goals of the project are kind of overarching. I'd like to map the distributions of turtles throughout the state. They are a very little studied animal in Connecticut. Identify important habitats. So areas where these animals are concentrated, which might be able to be protected if they're near a protected area, inside a protected area, or in an area that could be protected by even community support would be very helpful to identify. Locate areas of nesting abundance. Some of these turtles are migratory in their nesting, and they nest in the specific site year after year. So to identify areas would be beneficial to help protect those areas, especially from those subsidized predators I talked about, like foxes and raccoons and crows, things like that. Another good one is to detect roadways that have high mortality. There have been a number of projects throughout the state, or throughout the U.S., where there have been high mortality events with turtles that they have put in multi-million dollar projects with culverts underground to help move them back and forth through wetlands, and it's been very successful. In addition, this is a part of the program that I was hoping that would be a little more prevalent, but just through time concerns, is to have abilities for some of the participants to join me in field work and visiting sites. We've done it a couple times, but not nearly as much as I would like. And with that, I thank you for listening to me tonight, and I would be happy to entertain any questions.